So it is now my pleasure to introduce Ada Fay, CFO of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria, and Asie Toudiou, CFO of Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance. As you may recall, IFAC recently signed an MOU with both organizations, and its objective is to enhance the capacity of the accounts profession in support of the goal to build resilient and sustainable health sector system. The Global Fund and Gavi invest in public financial management and accountancy capacity because it ensures greater effectiveness in trust in the use of resources leading to more sustainable health outcomes. Ada, Asitu, thank you very much for accepting our invitation to join this panel discussion. So I'll start with you, Ada. Can you tell us about the Global Fund activities in supporting strong public health systems?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Darlene, and good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you're connecting from. For those of you who don't know the Global Fund was created in 2002 to really drive the fight against HIV, TB, and malaria, but particularly HIV, because when you know what HIV has done in the early 2000, late 90s and 2000 in sub-Saharan Africa, I think the funeral business was booming in Africa because of the impact of HIV. And thanks to the late Kofi Annan, who was the first donor of the Global Fund, we created a financing mechanism, which is all about leveraging partnership to create funding to fight these three diseases. And we invest now $4 billion a year in 120 countries to drive the fight against HIV, TB, and malaria. And in 2016 or 2015, we realized that as a financing mechanism, our strategy needs to include financial management as a key pillar to enable health impact and outcomes. As a Geneva-based organization without field presence, we have to leverage the partnership to work with partners, work with the financial management expertise, because I have the tendency to go beyond accounting and the accountancy professor. And IFAC became also a key pillar in that journey to enable financial management practices. And we have benefited a lot from that collaboration by reaching to a wide range of stakeholders to really enable the delivery of our mission. As we go through the journey and the MOU, we're in the process, we just got the approval of our board for the new strategy, and our ambition grew. And I've heard from my friends in Rwanda, because I know he's not on the call, but the Accountant General of Rwanda is a good friend of ours. Because Rwanda is one of the only countries in our portfolio where we're able to use the public financial management system end to end for the delivery of our program. Not only is it beneficial for Rwanda as a country, it also creates efficiency and effectiveness in the rollout of our model, because Rwanda is also the only country where we do a result-based financing approach, because we pay for outputs and not for inputs. So the role of finance is key, not only in our resource mobilization strategy, but also to drive impact and outcome in the delivery of our health programs. I'll pause there, and then we move on to other questions. And I'm very happy to be here. And I think we'll get on the point around the impact of COVID and the pandemic, which has even made this ambition of ours more important. Over to you, Darlene.
Thank you so much, Ada. Asitu, could you tell us about Gavi and its priorities and challenges, and particularly as it relates to the COVAX facility?
Thank you, and good morning, good afternoon, everyone. It's glad and honored to be talking to you today and to reconnect with some of you members with whom we already have, collaboration work. So about Gavi, Gavi has been created in 2000. It's a sister organization of the Global Fund on many levels. First, by being first an actor of the global health arena. So we really share the same mission to really strengthen global health, save lives, and contribute actually to a sustainable development. So this is something that we really are all doing. We're doing it through immunization, which is actually procuring vaccines and delivering vaccines to in more than 70 countries, but also building sustainable model within the global health system, and contributing actually to strengthening PFM. So this is what is Gavi doing. Gavi has been able to raise $30 billion since it has created. This year only, due to the COVAX pandemic, $10 billion have been raised in terms of resources. And we managed actually to immunize almost a billion of kids, saving 15 million of lives since we have started. Now we operate under a private public partnership model where we combine technical expertise from the development community, but also using the know-how of the private sector. Needless to say, it's absolutely important that global health is and remains a top agenda. COVAX actually has demonstrated, COVID has demonstrated that it's something which is critical. And we knowing actually the spillover effect on the economics in some countries, in the most vulnerable countries, there is really a need to make sure that we remain efficient, we remain close to the countries, and we provide support wherever is needed. And this is in this particular aspect that we absolutely would benefit from strengthening the ties that we currently have with the wider profession. Over to you, Darlene.
Thank you both. I actually have a question, and you've both hinted at it already, but just if we could expand a little on why is strengthening PFM so important to what you do? So maybe I start with you, Ada.
Thank you very much. And I think it is a very good question. And I remember in 2016, when we started, a lot of our programmatic colleagues asked us the same question in public health. Why is PFM a key pillar in the strategy of any public health organization? Maybe COVID has made it known to the world today because the economic impact of COVID, which is a health problem, has impacted every aspect of the economy, from the livelihoods of the informal workers in the streets of many of the countries to the airlines and to the big corporation. However, let's go back to 2002, and I put it on HIV, TB, and malaria. An organization that pushed over $4 billion in financing at country level to run treatment and prevention programs in the most vulnerable and weak systems from a corruption index standpoint, from a capacity standpoint, if financial management and PFM is not an enabler and a driver of success, then you are in the wrong business. And we've seen it in the Global Fund, because when we started, financial management was not a component in our strategy. And in 2011, we almost went out of business because not because of the lack of outcomes, the programmatic impact was evident. We have saved over 38,000 lives through the partnership. We work with people who live with the disease. And in 2011, we almost let them down because of poor financial management practices in the implementation of our programs. We saw misappropriation and fraud at the highest level. And it is post that event, we realized the importance of finance in the delivery of our program. And when you look at the Global Fund of the pre-2012 and the Global Fund today, I can tell you by investing in finance, it has enabled us to respond to the COVID pandemic, but it also enabled our implementers at country level to be ready. And we were, if not the first organization after Gavi, because COVAX is one of the biggest global health initiatives in the last 18 months. But after COVID, apart from the vaccine, if you look at the actual flow of funds into countries, Global Fund is among the highest that was able to mobilize and drive $4 billion in 18 months to put it at the disposal of some of the most vulnerable and weakest economies in the world to fight the pandemic. And for us, this is a key pillar around when we talk about the resilient system for health. Everything in the health sector is about the finances. And when you look at a lot of the countries, I always use the example of audit. When we did the landscape of audit, many of our government counterparts, there is a delay in audit reports of 5 to 8 years. If counterpart financing is a key component of what you're doing, if it is a partnership where we should co-fund our initiative and you don't have proper books of records, how are we able to drive the change that is needed? Global Fund is a gap-filling organization. The countries that receive most resources from us are those who are able to establish the actual financing gap in their fight against HIV, TB, and malaria. To identify financial gap, you need very strong financial management system to be able to articulate the gap. And that is why Rwanda is a star in our portfolio, plus many other countries who have been able to understand the trick of the business to say that as a gap-filling organization, financial management has to be a priority for everybody involved in this. We don't have country presence. We leverage what we call our local fund agents and leverage accountants and financial managers on the ground to provide us with the assurances that the funds that we provide to countries are put in better use. In many countries, we have to fly in that expertise because it is not available at country level or it is not available in the right numbers. And that is where also IFAC and the work that you're doing, that is why where it kicks in. For me, everything that we do, and I'm so passionate about finance, everything that we do in the Global Fund now evolves around finance. We're a key player in the decision-making process. And that is why I think it is important for us to help the countries to be able to develop their financial management, people, processes, and systems in a way that it should not be a discussion around what is needed to drive the change. And I repeat, if COVID has not taught the world anything about the importance of finance in global health, I don't know what will. Over to you, Laura.
Thank you, Ada, and your passion absolutely comes through there. Asetu, I have a sort of a related question to that, I guess, and I'm wondering whether you can just go into some of the financial and fiduciary risks to your activities and just thinking about how PFM systems might help to mitigate these.
Thank you, and you know, really want to acknowledge what has been said by Ada before and by Ed also in terms of, you know, why is PFM important? This is a question that people we may not ask in the private sector. I just wanted to tell you, we would like to see the private sector, the public sector operating such as a private sector. You know, there are some kind of even components such as value for money that we apply, you know, in contrastly to the private sector. Sorry, we have reached a time where we would have to operate, you know, using the same values, using the same pillars, using the same frameworks. So just before actually I go to you, to your point, having a framework, an overall framework for the public sector is for me, you know, paramount if we really want to build sustainable economies. Now, talking about, you know, the risks, you know, Ada touched upon a little bit about it. Public sector, and specifically when it comes to organizations such as ours, operate using public funds. So what it means for us, we use actually international development aids. We do have a stewardship for these resources which are entrusted to us, and making sure that they're being used to the intent and to the benefit of population. That's actually the mandate of every large public organization. So value for money is something that you cannot measure unless you do have the tools to do that. So, you know, reporting, accountability, framework, standards are something that is very critical for us. Now, in terms of risk, a large amount of money have been flown recently. We need actually to understand where this money has gone, how it has been spent. We also need to understand sustainability. Are we investing money where it should be? And then our organization are catalytic in supporting health system strengthening. And we work with you know, many stakeholders from Ministry of Finance, from oversight institutions such as SIIs, and also the accounting profession in order to provide support when it comes to technical assistance to the public sector. So these are the major risks that we have seen in terms of, you know, making sure that, you know, money flows where it should go. Do we have the value for money? Do we have the budget utilization? And providing actually support, overall support to programmatic needs. So over back to you, Laura.
So Gavi and the Global Fund recently signed an MOU with IFAC with the aim of enhancing the capacity of the accounts profession. So how important is collaboration with the global accounts profession to your work? And what more can the profession do also at the local level to support the goal of helping to build resilient and sustainable health sector system? I believe you hinted to it, but Asito, maybe you could start.
I let maybe Ada develop a little bit. We already have a lot of initiative and collaboration. Many of our partners are already in this call. Don't want to name them all, but definitely we need to do more. We need to do much more in order to be effective, in order to bring impact actually. And I truly believe that, you know, given the skill set, the knowledge, the exposure of an organization such as IFAC, who can drive actually, and Ed has said it in his talk, you know, together we represent actually the, in French we say la crème de la crème, right? When it comes, you know, when it comes to set up standards, understand actually how to report, driving actually this agenda of good governance, reporting, and accountability, all these kind of key principles that we are custodian on needs to be cascaded down to operationalize it within our program. Ada.
Thank you very much. And I'll step on two things to answer that. We have two opportunities. The number of countries that use, let's say, even strategic purchasing. When you look at Gavi and Global Fund, because of some of the inefficiencies in the value chain around procurement of vaccines and drugs, sometimes we do it at global level. Doing it at global level means that we're not equipping some of the countries to do it. However, most countries use, let's say, individual tendering. And because you don't have the scale, you're not able to drop down prices. I use ARVs, for example, in 2002, 20 years ago, to keep a person on treatment for a year costs over $10,000. Today, through a strategic purchasing process and element, we brought down that cost to $200 per year. It is significant. However, would individual countries have been able to do that? No. But how do we use accountants working with governments to look at the government value chain as part of the PFM agenda and see where do we have the opportunities to just drive a strategic purchasing mechanism? I have always built the case around the importance of PFM using the ambition of the Global Fund Board, which is to raise money and to spend it in countries. 5 years ago, Global Fund was only able to spend 60% of money that is mobilized, because countries are not able to absorb all of the money that is available to them to fight the disease. However, it's a dilemma. When you look at Africa, for example, or Asia, where we invest the most, you wonder why any government will return millions of dollars due to inefficiencies of the PFM system. Why do they do it? They don't have the reporting mechanisms. They don't have the monitoring approaches to even understand what is the approved level of your grant, how much are you spending, and what do you need to optimize? In the last 5 years, we created an optimization framework, provided flexibility with countries to show them if you have good financial management systems and processes, we allow you to optimize up to 15% of our grant by moving it to other priority areas. That has changed and enabled us to move from a 60% utilization to 85% utilization at the end of 2020. 15% of a $20 billion fund is still a significant amount of money that countries are losing due to the inefficiency of the financial management system and processes. And I think as citizens of the world, and I always say, as I call myself a child of the continent, we have a responsibility to work with our stakeholders. And I have this ambition that the day I will do my job well for Global Fund is the day where Africa absorbs 95 to 99% of the funds that are allocated to save the people of Africa. And that can only be done through accountants. It is not the president of a country. It is not the minister of agriculture or health. It is the accounting professor that should be able to show governments, show countries, how do you optimize? And when I talk about it to ministers, they say you are a success story. The health budget, we are not even able to spend 60% at the end of the year. It's a failure of the accounting professor. And we should defy processes, procedures, techniques to really serve the people of the world by making sure that funds which are allocated to health are utilized for health. And that is the only way we will fight pandemics like COVID. The issue is not money. The issue is around coming together and efficiently show the world what we can do for them as professional accountants. Over to you.
Ada, Sietu, thank you so much for joining us today. I look forward to working together further to support the implementation of the MOU. I think collaboration is the word of the day. Laura, over to you to close the session.
Thank you, Darlene. And I would also just like to say a big, big thank you to all of our panelists. I think there were some really, really powerful messages for our profession during this session. So Ed, Obadiah, Amin, Ada, Setu, thank you so much for your excellent contributions on what is such an important topic for our profession. And at the start of the session, I mentioned collaboration. Darlene, you mentioned collaboration, and this really did resonate throughout all of the presentations, just how important this is to successful PFM reform. I'd now like to hand it over to my colleague, Joe Bryson, to take questions from the council.
Hello, I'm not on screen. Oh, there I am. Okay. Thank you again to our panelists. It's wonderful to have you with us. I will jump right into our first question. This actually goes to Ed. Ed, also understand you may need to leave us. So, Ed, at the end of your presentation, you made 5 recommendations to the profession. The question is, how can PAOs work with the development partners to act on them now?
Many thanks, Joe, and good morning, good afternoon. It's really nice to be with you here. So I think I would like to look at this from two different angles. The first one is we need to recognize the donor architecture. So the way we development partners work is we have operations at the global level. We also have operations at the country level. So you have some donors that operate at the country level. So I think in terms of collaboration, PAOs will have to really look at how they work with development partners, for instance, within a country to be able to advance specific agendas. So if we talk, for instance, about the agenda regarding implementation of Accrual Accounting or strengthening the public sector strengthening certified accountants in the public sector, I think they will need to work at that kind of country level with the donors at that level and also the country authorities. But that does not mean that IFAC does not have a role in this, because you were talking principally about PAO. I think there are also ways that IFAC globally could then also engage with donors, like say the World Bank. We operate at a global and country level. You take each of the other donors, their structure is similar to that as well. So they will have to have a way that they can collaborate with organizations like Gavi, Global Fund, the World Bank, and others at the global level to further advance the work that is being done at the country level. And they can also support, for instance, the PAO on some of these specific issues. For instance, how do you increase the public sector content of the professional qualifications? How do you ensure that you have specific focus on public sector accountants in continuing professional development, and so on and so forth? I think IFAC can develop some kind of public goods that individual PAOs can adapt as appropriate. Then in terms of really also the mechanism of this, I think we can talk about partnership, okay? That is PAOs partnering with development partners, but we can also talk about financing. Okay, for instance, the World Bank, Global Fund, Gavi, and other development partners, there are opportunities for them to be able to provide financing. And that financing, for instance, can be provided at the country level, but it can also be provided globally. And there I see a role again for IFAC. And we know about the funding, I think, from DFID that IFAC was able to use to support. I know currently now there is the MOU that has been signed with Gavi and Global Fund. So there is scope to be able to work with other development partners as well and be able to have that kind of support mobilized globally as well. So those are the two areas that I think we can focus on. But I think if you also look at the various recommendations I made, I think there are ones that these PAOs are responsible for. There are ones that IFAC will really have to take the lead. If you take, for instance, the issue I mentioned about financial accountability index, promoting that better, I think IFAC can take the lead, PAO can support. So there are issues that PAOs and IFAC will need to work together on. So I think let me stop there.
Thank you so much. Next question is for both Asetu and Ada. And Asetu, I saw your hand up earlier. So if you'd like to add to this question. So this is, what are the longer term impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic for your work?
Let me start with this one. And you know, for me, even this question is a little bit premature. It's a little bit premature because the pandemic is not over. As we stand, we have delivered roughly 6 billion doses of COVID-19 vaccine. But guess what? 80% have been administered in high and upper middle income countries. And 73% of this volume in just 10 countries. Today, as we speak, end of September, if I look at my data, in low-income countries, the coverage is only, you know, a maximum of 2% of their populations. Today, as we speak, 56 countries have not reached the 10% coverage in their own countries. So having a long-term perspective is important, but unfortunately, we are still, you know, dealing with a short-term and near-term effect of the pandemic. Now, what I can tell you, however, and then, sorry, maybe one point also to add to what I just said. we are still operating with a highly uncertain environment, right? We still have a lot of volatility across the whole value chain, from supply to demand, from supply from manufacturers, even knowing about the virus. The virus, you know, mutates every I would say almost now every month. So we don't know yet. There are still things that we don't know yet. Supply still remain some challenge, and demand in countries, you know, has specific challenges. So looking at long-term, yes, it makes sense. We can't, you know, just narrow our perspective to what is happening now. But really, we're still, you know, in the midst of the pandemic, because Gavi's mandate, similarly as, you know, Global Fund to some extent, is really focusing on those who need it most. And those are currently, as I said, very far from having achieved the herd immunity that the WHO has recommended. Now, looking at what we know today, right, is that definitely this pandemic is putting years of progress at risk. At programmatic level, you have seen the disruption across the entire economic, but when it comes now to global health in particular, our routine immunization activities have been, you know, significantly affected. Both the health sector workers are shifting their priorities towards, you know, fighting the pandemic, hence not going through the normal agenda they would have followed for routine immunization. We have said in terms of, you know, financial management, a lot of resources have been, you know, dispersed in a very short time, and in, you know, in a context of emergency, which is, we know, all knows, you know, this kind of risk. We don't have the supporting, you don't have, you know, the procurement processes in place. So putting actually the risk in terms of, you know, using the resources as intended. And then the third point that I would say is that actually our major stakeholders in countries have shifted also priorities in terms of oversight. You know, it makes sense. It's a you know, national priority, global pandemic. But at the same time, we could see that maybe some of the reforms that were expected are at risk of being deprioritized. So putting actually the agenda of equity, you know, far behind, behind, you know, the COVID's priority. So that would be, let's say, my say, the pandemic is not over, we're not safe, we're not yet there, but this is, you know, what we can perceive at this stage of the process. Thank you.